This time I checked the microphone to make sure it was working, and sure enough, it pulled out, the jack had pulled out just a little bit, and it wasn't working. So it always pays to check. If ever there was a illustration of the term, the phrase, calm before the storm, this is it. Because I'm sitting here outside, and it is still, it is calm. The stars are twinkling, it's a full moon. You think, ah, what another beautiful California evening. And yet we are told on the news that by within 7 hours, 4 a.m., the winds are going to be shrieking up to 55 miles an hour. And driving rain and a very hard-hitting storm is going to pounce on us, which is the beginning of a series of storms over the next 6 days, which are going to saturate the area and dump up to a foot of rain on some of the coastal mountains here. Flooding, landslides, downed trees. It is going to be a wild, wild time as the Pineapple Express from Hawaii comes roaring in, and we've had this before here. So we know what that's like, and it can be pretty strong stuff. And yet right now, unbelievably still and calm before the storm. So it's very difficult for us to judge just from where we're at right now. We need more information. When we tune into the news, they have satellites, they have radar, they have all sorts of computer models, and they're able to determine where the jet stream is, where the main pressure systems are, where the moisture is. They now have satellites that can measure atmospheric moisture and like rivers of moisture, atmospheric rivers they're called, and they know that it's coming in. And it's very much like that with human events, the events in this world. As you try to judge just from today, very difficult to judge from any particular day. But if you have these advanced metrics that are able to somehow look and see what is coming, just like a meteorologist is able to tell what is coming and ahead of time, it is also possible to tell what is coming ahead of time as far as human events go. It's a different discipline, of course, than the meteorologist, but it's a discipline nonetheless. It's a discipline that I have worked on my entire life, but it's not infallible, just like the weather reports are not infallible, not at all. Their timing can be off, systems can stall, with the jet stream, how far it dips, they can't tell exactly how far it's going to dip, they're not exactly sure on a number of factors. But sometimes they get it pretty darn close, actually. Other times they're a little bit off, or quite a bit off. It's even more difficult to foretell exactly what's going to happen as far as human events go. But it is certainly worth paying attention to, and at least as a motivation to try and deepen your seeing into the entire situation. For example, tonight I seemed to be stuck, and then I said, suddenly a deepening came to me, and I saw it in a slightly different way, and I said, well, that seems to be a better explanation. It has to do with what we call the now. You hear a lot of people and teachers talking about the now, our present-mindedness and all of this. What I see is this entire scenario we're in is a projection into an imaginary place that we can call the future. All of it. It's a hypothetical imaginary scenario, an imaginary place called the future, meaning a situation that hasn't yet taken place, but we're projecting it to take place. We're imagining it's going to take place, so we call this place the future. Now, within that future, this hypothetical scenario, there is what we call time. And this time has a past, a present, and a future to it. And yet, all of that time, both the past, the present, and the future, all of that is actually in this hypothetical place called the future, or a place where events that supposedly will take place have not yet taken place, but we're imagining them as if they had taken place. So the now that is being talked about in many cases, the now is still in the future, is still in this hypothetical scenario. It's not the eternal now. The eternal now is reality itself, which is something quite different than what's referred to as now as a time-based now, like present moment type of situation. Like I'm aware of the present moment. I'm aware of what's happening around me. A leaf just fell. A little breeze just came in. The lights are there. That's called present moment awareness. That is not what the eternal now is at all. Not at all. Entirely different. There's no correlation whatsoever that I can really see at this point. So there are different teachings depending on what we're talking about. And what I'm expressing and seeing is the eternal now, is that is our true home. We don't have any true home within this hypothetical scenario at all. Not at all. And yet what we're trying to do is we're trying to find a way to adapt to this. And so we think that the living in the now is somehow better adaptation, is that we seem to be more flexible and not bound by past associations, what we think about things based on the past, that we see things as they are now. But all of this is a hypothetical, imaginary scenario, all of it. So it doesn't really matter what kind of results we get. We're trying to learn how to adapt to this universe. Why? Because this universe is a symbolic expression of what we believe is going to happen to reality. And we believe that this universe is a model of the change of a changed reality, and that we our character in this, basically, you can call it a virtual reality, you can call it a matrix if you want to, update it in technological terms, etc. I call it hypothetical scenarios is more accurate, I would say, more to the point. But you can say, yes, it is a virtual reality. This situation is, the universe is a virtual reality. Yes, it is. It is a matrix-like situation. Not being generated by computers, being generated by the mind, actually. Some prefer to look at it, at least for now, in that way, which is fine. It's just fine. You can continue your inquiry using whatever terms you want. I'm very keen on trying to use terminology which is actually more helpful. When I say a hypothetical, an as-if scenario, it is, I feel that's very, very accurate way of referring to it. We are imagining this a situation as if it had already happened, but it hasn't happened yet in reality, and it never will happen. Which is our salvation. Our salvation comes from recognizing and knowing that we don't need to have any results in this hypothetical scenario of any kind, not even enlightenment, a realization, anything. No results are necessary whatsoever. Because this changed reality that we're trying to adapt to is never going to happen, is never going to arise at all. So obviously we don't need any adaptation. We don't need any learning. We don't need any present momentness in this. We don't need anything at all from it. Nothing at all from it. So we can act literally just forget about all of it and not put our attention on it at all. Then pragmatic questions arise, of course. But there's something to be said in focusing on the big picture context and not worrying too much about the pragmatic situations. We just have some faith that those will work out. Because if we get obsessed with the pragmatic, practical questions, we can get very fearful, like, oh, how will I function? What will I do? Etc. like that. And we have examples of those who have dropped it, who have functioned just fine. So reason would tell us it's not a problem. We may not understand why it's not a problem, but it is not. That's why teachers are ambassadors of servitude are so important in this world. We see that they're functioning fine. For instance, A Course in Miracles talks great job in setting the context, and yet there's no one in the world, an ambassador of certitude linked with that course right here now or in the recent times, that we can look at and see that they're functioning perfectly well. Because if we listen to A Course in Miracles, it's so abstract that it's super hard to come up with any pragmatic way of functioning. We're just told that everything will be fine and perfect for us. But where's the example is the question. So that is part of the problem. It is difficult if you don't have someone here functioning in a very practical, pragmatic way. Now, Ananda Maima was here in the world, and she functioned in a super practical way. In fact, people were absolutely dazzled by how absolutely efficient and practical she was in every matter. Superbly practical and pragmatic, and yet totally free of delusion and knowing this whole thing is nothing but a dream. And not identifying with bodily consciousness in the slightest bit. And yet still able to function flawlessly here. And people would just say, this is incredible. But an example like that, you see, hey, it really is very possible. And Ramana Maharshi the same way. He functioned perfectly fine. Not a problem at all. It's helpful if there was some pragmatic example, I would say, like A Course in Miracles. The examples so far have been not sufficient. Teachers of A Course in Miracles have not been sufficient from my standpoint, of someone that is truly realize that this is all simply a hypothetical scenario. We need absolutely no results whatsoever. And yet still is functioning very practically and pragmatically like that. So it is difficult. Let's be honest. Let's not argue with facts. It is difficult and somewhat fearful to hear that just follow your joy or hear these platitudes, spiritual platitudes, when in fact it is brutally difficult in this world. It seems that way for us to survive at all. I feel like I'm skating on the thinnest of thin ice at every single moment here in this world. And it's follow my joy. I've tried that and it's a disaster. There's more to it than that. It's kind of like if we see the world as 100% perfect or it's a nightmare. It's not like 99% is not it at all. It has to be 100%. Has to be. The realization has to be total. One has to abide in the realization. That's part of the 100%. You don't have 100% realization if you don't abide in it 100% of the time. You do not. And if you don't do that, the world is extremely problematical, actually. Extremely problematical. I mean, where are the jobs to pay for everything you need to pay for and to deal with everything you need to deal with? And things are getting more and more bureaucratic and difficult all the time. We don't live in a time of burros and donkeys, and we just get a donkey and it'll take us somewhere. I mean, I drive for a living, and every second that I'm driving, I have to be hyper-vigilant, and I'm acutely aware of my vulnerability, and I have to be. I can't let up for a second, and there are a bunch of knuckleheads on the road. I mean, it's amazing what's happening. For example, there's a huge uptick in people who at traffic signals when they're stopped at a red light, who when the light turns green are completely oblivious to it. I'm very aware of that because I'm stopped at stoplights many, many times a day, every day. And in the past, I would go months and months and months and not a single instance of somebody not going when the light turns green. Now, there are multiple instances every single day, multiple. And I'm having to honk my horn. We're so polite here in California, we don't honk horns. But I'm sitting, if I don't honk a horn, they'll miss the entire light. It'll turn red again. So I think, beep, beep, beep. Come on, people like shocked, like, oh my gosh, what are they doing? I think they're texting, or looking at their smartphones, actually, or their tablets. They're very distracted. And in driving, people are very distracted. And in running, today I had a runner. I had a green light, and they just ran in dark right in front of us. Look, there's a car in front of me, right in front of us. I said, "What are you doing? You can see it. You got a red light, and you just keep right on running right in front of the cars, like nothing's happening, and no one honks their horn." See, in California, political correctness is a disease. It is a disease, a severe disease. Nobody is willing to say anything to anybody. They're terrified. It's nuts here. And it's not a helpful thing at all. Nobody's doing anybody any favors by not speaking up. So I feel like here, speaking up like this is like the is blasphemous for Californians to do such a thing. Absolutely blasphemous. Heretical. You simply do not say anything that might offend anybody or that might not be all-inclusive to everybody. But what can anyone say that is all-inclusive here? You're going to exclude some, right? And you're made to feel guilty if we say anything that could be in the slightest way exclusive of anybody, which is insane. Because if you stand up for truth, those who want to believe in that belief is true will say, well, you're excluding us. And if you stand up for belief and say belief is true, those who want to know truth will say, you're excluding us. So this political correctness is a paralysis, and it only serves the status quo, and the status quo here is belief. Is belief. Status quo is this hypothetical scenario. It's a way of trying to limit and squelch any talk whatsoever about it. And I don't know how I've got off on this tangent, but let's keep going because it's a good one. People, compared to how it used to be, are so stifled in their expression, it is night and day. Like compared to the 60s when I grew up, it is absolutely night and day. The people at that time that were speaking up now, they are straitjacketed. Straight-jacketed, and their desire to speak up has been channeled into desire to control others and prevent them from speaking up and expressing divergent viewpoints. And the whole thing is being run by so-called don't want to give offense to anybody. That is so nuts. I mean, the whole idea of America is that Americans are supposed to accept the fact that they will be offended by different viewpoints here. And we're supposed to have very thick skins, and we're supposed to welcome divergent viewpoints and not try to impose any particular viewpoint on the whole through federal laws of any type at all, which is why the federal government is supposed to be severely limited in America, unlike the rest of the places in the world, apparently, who want to have a total consensus of 100% thinking a certain way. In America, no, we're happy to celebrate the diversity of different viewpoints, different perspectives, and there may be some that feel that they're right, and we say, that's okay. It is something like we say, please, we like to hear different viewpoints, and we want an opportunity to weigh these viewpoints without threats of reprisal. Which means you need a very limited federal government and state governments not interfering, not trying to use their clout and their power to push a particular politically correct viewpoint on the body politic. That is totally un-American, totally. And yet the rest of the world is now exercising their muscles to try to intimidate the United States to adopt this idea of forcing a particular viewpoint using the government and the bureaucracy to enforce a viewpoint on the body politic, which is, again, totally un-American. There's no point even in living in America if that's the way it's going to be. Because the reason why we live here is because we want to be free to express ourselves without threats of reprisal. But the threats of legal reprisal are now becoming severe here, very severe, to the point where those who are speaking out are afraid to speak out. Very much so. So that's why I say America's died. It really has. And with it, the hope in the world has really died. Because you cannot have government imposing their viewpoint. Because government is going to impose something that makes it easier to govern. What else are they going to do? Of course they're going to do that. And in this world, the default is believing in belief. This entire is believing we're supposed to work for results in this world, which of course government can make a country more efficient. Like so you have a Singapore or someplace that, you know, is super efficient, super clean. You have a hyper totalitarian government. They can make everybody. But what is lost there? What is lost is the feeling of freedom to recognize that we don't need any results at all. This is only a dream. That's what's lost. And so you throw out the baby with the bathwater when you try to impose hyper-efficiency to raise the standard of living. You throw out the baby with the bathwater. And you lose sight of what the real purpose, our real responsibility actually is here. You lose sight of it. which is why it's such a terrible situation now in the world, when basically the United States decided we're going to go for big government, we're going to go for big bureaucracy, we're going to go for central planners, we're going to go for Ivy League people who supposedly know what's best for us, and we're going to use the federal government, all the judicial system and activism to impose these supposed right viewpoints on the whole body politic as a whole, and institute severe reprisals for those who don't go along. And most of the world, 90% of the world, agrees that this is the right way to go. You have a terrible situation, which many in the United States are very aware of, because what you're losing, the pathway to freedom is being obscured. It's like there's bushes growing over and brambles in the jungle, and you don't even realize it's there. It's pretty interesting. My dad was, part of what he did was an explorer, and he rediscovered the Temple of Tikal down there in the Yucatan Peninsula. It had been discovered before by a University of Pennsylvania team. And they had gone down, they had cleared the jungle out, but they had lost their funding in World War I, World War II, various things happened. And the jungle completely grew back and covered it, and nobody really knew it was there, and they completely forgot about it. And he went down there, and I guess he got wind of it, that there was some temple there. And he found a guide there, a native guide that was able to guide him through this jungle. And he rediscovered it, and he had photos and everything. It was completely covered with jungle. The jungle repossessed it. So, and then after that, the University of Pennsylvania went back down there, and they eventually cleared it out. Now it's a major tourist attraction. And of course, he had many stories of the jungle animals and spiders and snakes and all the stuff that happened on there. It was absolutely amazing. But this shows you that a way that is open can be occluded. It can be obscured. And the people can lose any realization. The people didn't even know it existed at all. They had lost that knowledge completely. And that happens in this world very rapidly, actually. And it is happening now, and that is why I'm really very, very concerned about the situation, and I've seen it growing. I've been forewarned about all of this. Is that those who want freedom and don't want any reprisals for being able to at least consider and weigh openly and say, hey, and challenge authority and say, wait a minute. Is this serving my best interests? What are my best interests? You know, a vigorous discussion, vigorous debate, which is what America has always been about, supposed to be about. Vigorous disagreement. We can agree to disagree civilly and respectfully, but there's vigorous debate and vigorous disagreement, and that at least keeps roads open. And under a situation, you can see that this road will take me to freedom, and this one will is a dead end. You're able to, but the threat of reprisals is becoming prohibitive now. It is becoming prohibitive, which is why this election was so important, because there was really two different directions. There was an option where the reprisals were kind of going to be tampered down. Say, hey, look, let's back away from trying to set a particular mindset through the government, and let's back away from trying to put pressures and reprisals to reach that, even though of course the central planners believe they know best. But the whole thing about America is Americans have a right to determine what they think is best for themselves. You see, that's a whole different thing, which is why I valued and respected America, because here I felt like it's up to me to decide what is best for me. It's not up to the government to decide what is best for me. It's up to Americans to decide for themselves what they feel is best for themselves. Even if maybe there's somebody up there who knows better, okay, they have no right to impose it through the federal government and through the judicial system and through the bureaucracy and through all these laws and decrees, etc. They have no right to impose that and to through fear and through threat, etc., through loss of employment, through lawsuits, all this stuff. They don't have any right to impose that, even if they do know better, because ultimately each one of us has to see for ourselves what the path to salvation is. We can't have it imposed from on high. We cannot. which is why we have freedom of religion here too, because religions tend to want to impose. They think they know the truth. And they say, okay, now that is fine for those who voluntarily want to join that teaching and listen to it and abide by these teachings and consider it. That is fine. But we also have freedom for other religions to come and say, well, this is what we believe too. And there's no one has a right to set up a state religion here. No one has that right. And so this is the right way in this world, because each one of us has to see for ourselves. Just because I say something, that's not your own seeing. It can attract you to work, it can motivate you, but it's not your own seeing. Each one of you has your own seeing. And your own seeing has to develop to a point where you choose what is truly freedom. There is no other way. There is no other way. So a culture, a civilization has to foster this. And it's not smooth. It is not. Sometimes it's unruly. Sometimes it seems somewhat uncivilized, because everyone has different perspectives. But there has to be this freedom and respect for others' perspectives and the way they want to say it. They may be speaking of the same thing, but they say it in a different way. There has to be tolerance of that. That plurality, that infinite plurality in the world of everyone having a slightly different perspective. And there also has to be the right for those to say, hey, I found it, and for those and others to respond to them too. That's also allowable. It's a potpourri. It's not all neat and tidy. But that's the price you have to pay. And when you become lazy and you say, you know, I just don't want to work on it my own, I just want it to be imposed upon me, then you support having a viewpoint imposed upon you, which will never work for you. Never. Will never work. That's why religions really don't work. Not that they're wrong, they simply don't work. They really haven't worked in this world. Because they're basically people going and saying, just ultimately, it's impose the viewpoint on me. I want you to impose it upon me, and I want to learn how to function within this context that you're setting for me. And they want that because it's lazy. It seems to bypass the effort that is needed. They say, hey, this seems like the easy way. Now, you can be speaking truth. I mean, so if there could be a religion that is speaking the truth, absolutely the truth. Not that there is in this world necessarily, but there certainly could be. But you still can't impose that upon people. They have to come to it through their own organic process of inquiry and clarification, which is why satsang is so important, which is why contemplation is so important, which is why meditation is so important, which is why your own time is so important. You have to have a situation where you have your own time to mull it over, to research, to think, to consider within your own thought process. And you have to get it for yourself. Nobody can get it for you. Nobody can get it for you. Nobody can set up a religion that will work for you. The best religion can do is act as a motivation, as an example, as a discipline, which is all beneficial if you use it the right way. But what I've seen is too many people are there simply because they're lazy. I attend Catholic Church. I'm not a Catholic, but I attend Catholic Church. And I've attended other churches in the past too. And I see people are lazy. They're lazy. They just are marking time, thinking that it's going to be done for them in some magical way. It will not. It will not. And so they're wasting their time. There's nothing wrong with the discipline of the church. There's a lot of good things about it. But people aren't using it in the right way at all. They're not using the opportunity. And the church has just gotten used to this fact that the opportunities are not being utilized sufficiently. And they kind of accepted that people are going to be lazy. And so we'll just go with that. Maybe it's a lesser of two evils that they see. And maybe it is. Maybe it is. Maybe it could be worse, actually. Now, the right and the left, there's a lot about, in this world, a realization in the United States, there's a right and there's a left. There's the liberal progressives and the social Christian conservatives or whatever, conservatives, constitutionalists, etc., right and the left. But from my standpoint, they're actually two hands of one body. They're the same, really. They both have the same objective. One is worshiping the God belief. The other is saying there is no God at all. It's both the same mistake. It's the same mistake. One is trying to say that the prime creator isn't real and substituting a fake God for the true God, and then worshiping that fake God, the God of belief, the God of the hypothetical scenario. We've imagining there's a God that created this hypothetical scenario and is governing over it, et cetera, whereas the fact is, no, we are imagining it. And as a way of refusing to acknowledge that we're the ones who gave rise to this. So there are those who worship this hypothetical God of the hypothetical scenario, and there are those who say, no, there is no God of the hypothetical scenario, and there is no God at all. So it's both the same mistake, isn't it? It's both a denial of the true God. Both the same. It's just different ways of doing it. So you have the left and the right arguing at each other, and actually they're completely complicit because their agenda is exactly the same. Exactly the same. It's just different ways to try to obtain the results, different ways to try to adapt to this hypothetical scenario. That's all it is, which is why I call myself an independent, which is why I vet both sides. I vet both sides. Now, sometimes I see that one side may not be quite as bad as the other, but they're both need to be severely vetted. And do we have a society where that is allowed? And what I see, the danger I see in America is just the polarization is so extreme now that they're cutting out the middleman, so to speak. They're cutting out the independents. They're cutting out the ones who say, whoa, 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 I don't like either one of these. It's a two-party system. And it just seems we cannot allow for differing perspectives. They're both fighting over who is going to impose their perspective on the rest of us. And right now is the secular, the liberal progressive secular Marxists who are prevailing at this point. And the Christian conservatives are losing the battle, actually. And for me, that it is not a good thing at all, what is taking place. Now, if the Christian conservatives were winning the battle, that also wouldn't be a good thing, because they'd be imposing their dogma on the rest. However, their dogma does have some potential if you can use it in a certain way, but it also can be quite bad. I mean, throughout history, the imposition of this Christian dogma on the world has been quite harsh, and hasn't really had the kind of results that they would have hoped, because again, you can't impose it. But on the other hand, there's also been some very, very beneficial things that it's done. Some discipline, some certain type code of civility and morality and all of that, that is actually quite helpful. Same with Islam. Islam has a lot of helpful aspects to it. But again, it also has the qualities that Christianity has of imposing a particular viewpoint very strictly. So those things are actually not, they're counterproductive. You have to allow more freedom than that. And you have to allow people the freedom to be mistaken. And you also have to allow examples of certitude to come into the world and be free enough to allow that. Now, India has allowed that throughout their history. They have allowed quite a few examples of certitude to come into their society. They seem to have a plurality which allows for this. And it seems to be a jumbled mess. Hinduism seems it's a very jumbled mess. It seems to be like every possible viewpoint is tossed around, etc. And so it's hard to gain like a central cohesive viewpoint there. But it allows these ambassadors of certitude to arise there, like Ramana Maharshi, Nand Maima. Some would say Meher Baba was one of those. Others would talk about Punjaji and various other teachers. Many of them actually are talked about, and they had different viewpoints, different expressions, but somehow they gave this overriding context, which was so important. And they supported all these differing viewpoints in different ways. And it seems historically to have been more successful, even though, again, it's very uneven. And like Christianity is down to the level of now trying to raise saints up, and like Catholicism, picking their saints about who was martyred. Somebody who said, "Yeah, go ahead. I'm going to keep preaching. You go ahead and kill me if you want, but I'm going to keep preaching." And then they say, "Well, that's someone we want to say is blessed, and then we're going to raise them to a status. Maybe if someone claims some miracles from them posthumously, and while they were alive as a saint." We're really, really, is that an ambassador of certitude, or is that simply someone who wants to impose, so strongly wants to impose their viewpoint on others, they're willing to die for that, hoping that the other will back down, or this will eventually result in the victory or the triumph of their viewpoint? Or is that what it is? You see, that should be raised a question. Should be raised a question. Because in real freedom, you will say, oh, you'll feel others have the freedom of their viewpoint too, and the issue of martyring yourself is not it at all. It is not it. That is not a saint that martyrs themselves like that. Because why would a saint die for a particular viewpoint? Because their whole perspective is, you're free to have your own viewpoint. I'm not fighting against your viewpoint. I'm saying that I'm blessing your viewpoint. I'm blessing your freedom. You're free to see things the way you want to see them. I'm not here to impose my viewpoint on you. I'm here to invite you and attract you and motivate you if you want to be. If you don't, then you're free not to. So what is there a situation of martyrdom in such a situation? There is not. There absolutely is not. A real saint is one who's awoken from the dream and realized they were the dreamer of the dream. And this entire scenario is a hypothetical scenario, and that's all it ever has been. And there doesn't need to be any results from this whatsoever. And reality is completely untouched by this hypothetical scenario. And the change in reality that this hypothetical scenario is based on will never happen. Will never happen. And they're certain of this. They know it. They've awoken from the dream. That's a real saint. That's an ambassador of certitude. And that's what we're lacking in the world right now, because we've gotten caught up in who's going to triumph over who, which is madness. And that's why I'm one reason out of many that I'm super concerned about the world and the way direction that it's going. Because the United States was the last bastion of this freedom, the last bastion in the world. There is no other place in the world even remotely like it. Even remotely, like people give lip service to democracy, blah, 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 blah. Come on. Democracy was just a servant of the people here and was just a secondary sideshow. The real point of it was the spirit of the people themselves and their willingness to engage and willingness to say, I don't know the answers. Let's find out. Let us engage in a dialogue. Let us engage in this effort to know, to find out, to let it be known within us. And we understand that it's not an even path. We understand that there are difficulties. We understand that people will scorn us. And we understand that we may scorn them. We may say, you're not right. But we also understand that we need to love one another, respect one another within this process. And eventually people got weary of it. Enough people finally said, either they didn't have the spirit, either they came here simply for greed, which many people have come to the United States simply to get wealthy. They're not real Americans. They don't understand the purpose of America. You can get wealthy anywhere in the world, but the idea is easier here, supposedly. And so people came here, they say, I want more money. That's why I'm here. I want to get money. I want to buy a better house. I want things. I want material things. So materiality has won out. Simply demographically, it's winning out. And so we have to accept the facts. Those are facts. And I'm very accepting. I say, okay, those are the facts. There's no point in fighting a losing battle per se like that. Because again, you're not trying to triumph. The battle is not to triumph. The battle is to get free, is to escape for yourself based on your own clarity. Only your own clarity can make a meaningful choice between options. Nobody else's clarity can make the choice for you, make it meaningful for you. If you're still confused, it's not going to be meaningful, your choice. And therefore, it's not really a choice at all. There's no conviction. There will be no abidance. You might for one second see it one way, and then another second you'll see it another way. And that'll just result in confusion. And you'll decide, whoa, 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 this is too confusing. I'm going to go right back to belief, which what I'm used to. You'll go back to the familiar, which is the hypothetical scenario. So you can't succeed that way. Cannot succeed. You have to clarify. You have to have the opportunity to clarify. In times of oppression in the world, of political correctness, of bureaucracy, central planning, imposing their will on the body politic, there are those who would simply go off into the desert somewhere and have their own, like the Essenes or something like that, the Desert Fathers, Cappadocia, Egypt, various places. They would go to places and they're pretty isolated and then have that freedom of dialogue there and work it out, try to work through the difficulties there. They go to a monastery. So it may be that that will happen again, but the exodus now may be these places may be in a different world, different planet, different dwelling place, actually, because the one world, the centralized planning is now not just in each country, but there will be one for the entire world, and will impose, the whole world will impose upon itself a particular dogma and viewpoint, and saying for the sake of getting any better results in the world from our actions, we need, everybody needs to be on the same page religiously, money-wise, ideologically, dogma, discipline, the whole thing will be decided for us by some central planning, and that doesn't serve anyone well at all. Doesn't serve anyone well, because again, only your own clarity can make a meaningful choice between options. No central planner imposing something on you can result in that. If that was the case, couldn't the Catholic Church impose something on all the parishioners and they would get it? As Jesus said, the light within us is here now. You don't have to wait till heaven for that. It's here right now. It's always been with us. It's always been with us. So don't you think if you could impose that realization on it, it would already happen long ago? It hasn't happened at all. You can't impose it on anyone because, again, abidance is what's necessary. Not just a brief glimpse. That is not freedom. That would not be a meaningful choice at all. If you're vacillating between the two, how is that a meaningful choice? That's just witness to confusion. You don't know which one you want. That's not clarity. So, the entire hypothetical scenario is upheld by what I call the logical plausibility. It seems like reason, but it's not. So the way out of this situation is really, the way I see it, is to strengthen your reason, your capability to truly reason, which is what I've done, which is what A Course in Miracles basically tells us. This is what needs to be done and helps us, and other teachings do too. And when you do that, you suddenly catch belief in all these half-truths and plausibility, which you can see is not true at all. Not true at all. False premise, all these tricky ways that it uses that we take as reason. We believe that this is reasonable, what is going on. It is totally unreasonable. But how can we see it unless we know what reason really is? Once we know what reason really is, then we can contrast and compare. And we say, wait a minute, belief, you're not using reason at all. What are you using? And I call it the logic of plausibility. It's plausible that this is true, but it's not. It's only plausible. It's not really true. It's only hypothetically true. Or they call the logic of hypotheticalness, but I call it plausibility, because hypothetical is like plausible. Like it's plausible this could happen one at some point, but we don't know if it will or not. It's just plausible. And that there's a whole reasoning, system of reasoning, of logic that arises from this, a system of logic that belief uses. And what I see in the world is people have no idea the difference between this logic and actual true reason. They don't have a clue. So how can they make a meaningful choice, really, that results in abidance, which is decisive, saying, this is what I really want, and this I don't really want this. This is what is really true, and this is what's only hypothetical. How can they differentiate between the hypothetical and reality and see that the change in reality the hypothetical is modeling will never take place? How can we see it if we keep putting the logic of plausibility on the same level as reason and saying they're equal? It's impossible. It is impossible if you put those on the same level and you can't differentiate between the two, because they speak of different outcomes, of different, a totally different situation. They contradict each other entirely. Different conclusions entirely. So how can you put them on the same level and make a clear, meaningful choice between the two? The choice won't be meaningful. You'll only think you need to give some time to one and some time to the other, and then you'll oscillate. And the trouble is, when you choose reality and the overlay, it is so wonderful, you want to stay with it forever, and then you'll feel like you're being entrapped because you say, no, I got to get back and spend some time with the other one too, because I'm not really sure which is right, and if I stay with this the whole time, I could be wrong. So it becomes fearful. It becomes fearful, which is why most people only give it a glimpse, and then it's fearful. Very few abide in it. Look at Ramana Maharshi. He was abiding in this truth. He was abiding in it. Very rare. And people came to him and said, wow, this is a whole different quality that is here. This is incredible. This is wonderful. This is amazing. And it was effortless abidance. Very rare here, yet super necessary here, super necessary. And we literally have to do that ourselves too. And that can only happen when we see that there's a meaningful choice. Otherwise, our glimpse of the overlay will end up being a fearful experience for us, because we feel somehow it's tricking us and trapping us to not give equal time to the other. See, it's entrapping us. So we cannot have a bureaucracy that mandates equal time. See, Americans saying we have a right to decide which is true. We're not saying we're supposed to give equal time to both. That is not the goal. The goal is to go through the process of deciding which is the logical plausibility and which is the reason, divine reason, so we can make a meaningful choice. And we understand that it may take some time and consideration. It will. But for central planning to come in and say you must give equal time to both, and that is set in stone, you know, that's another thing of saying, like, all inclusive, or don't leave anyone out. So if you want to give some time to this, you have to give some time to this, mandated. That's the end. That is the end of a meaningful civilization. Civilization has no more real purpose after that, except total delusion. And it will collapse. It will fall. It will implode. It will devour itself. It will devour itself. And the whole world cheering the course that America has now charted for itself is suicidal. It's basically a planet saying that they're decided to commit suicide, really. Because the willingness in the United States in the past to respect opposed viewpoints without trying to mandate that either one impose upon the other, or that there's some equal time has to be given to both. For instance, we have talk shows that are conservative, and we have talk shows that are liberal. We have media that's liberal, like television, networks, etc. And they're trying to impose laws on the talk shows, radio talk shows, that they have to give equal time to the liberal progressives, equal time on that particular show. That is so totally un-American, it's unbelievable. Just as it would be completely un-American to say that the liberal networks have to give equal time on their network for conservative, Christian conservative viewpoints. We mandate that, you see. That is nuts. That is nuts. People in America have a right to start a talk show. They have a right to have a YouTube channel. They have a right to do these things. And say, hey, this is correct. Spend all your time here if you like. There's nobody can say you can't spend all your time here. Just imagine if you spent all your time watching these videos and someone came up and said, hey, we noticed that you spent X amount of hours watching these videos. You now are mandated by law to spend X amount of time watching videos that completely contradict what is being said here. And if you don't, your severe reprisals are going to be upon you. That is where we're going in this world. And that is what the world is supporting. It is supporting that. All the countries of the planet said, yeah, this sounds like a good idea. Yay, I'm glad that America is finally getting on board and going this in direction. Now we can really go there really fast. It is deadly. It is terrible. Because if you thought that you would have to give X amount of time to listen to videos that gave the completely opposite viewpoint and confuse the heck out of you, you wouldn't listen to these videos at all in the first place, would you? Because you say, I don't want to be confused that way. And so you'd be in a state of paralysis. You'd be in a state of feeling hopeless and helpless and depressed. You would be in severe depression. And what happens when you're depressed? Suicide happens. And that's why I say the world is going in a suicidal direction, very severely. Because people will feel like, what's the use? I don't even want to do anything here. Because then it's going to be imposed upon me. I got to do the opposite. You know, what kind of madness is this? It is truly terrible. So I am so vocal about the option I see is literally sidestepping this whole situation, and something that I saw in a vision that showed me it will be possible and it will be done. It is possible to do this. And you don't have to know the truth to sidestep it. You simply have to be willing to be free, to feel free within yourself, to consider, to go through process of consideration and find, saying within your own self, I want to find out the truth for myself. And I don't want somebody mandating that because I look at for it in one direction for X amount of time, I therefore have to now reciprocate and do it X amount of time in some other way. That is the worst. The worst, the most deadly kind of law possible, the most stifling law possible. Because even if you go on a wrong path, you can say, hey, wait a minute, maybe this path hasn't been right, but I don't have to reciprocate time-wise. I may have spent thousands of years on this path. I don't want to spend thousands of years on some other path just merely reciprocating. I want to be some kind of reciprocal action. I want it to come from my internal motivation to do it, not from some legal law telling me I have to, imposing it upon me. That causes resentment in people and rebellion in people. And you cannot have a true spiritual path when it's based on resentment and rebellion. It has to come from a deep determination and a glimpse of clarity within you, and a glimpse of the goal within you, and seeing these ambassadors of certitude and saying, you know what, there's something there that I really want, and I deserve it, and I want to go for it. And nobody can tell me that I cannot do that. And then putting in the work yourself, putting in the work, that's where it comes from. So this situation in the world that it has developed over the recent decades, and that has been monitored by many people carefully, is an extraordinarily ill wind that is blowing, really. From the standpoint of your freedom and your true happiness, and of course there are those who know where your true freedom and true happiness can be found. Let's not fool ourselves about that. I'm 100% sure that Ananda Mai Ma knows exactly where our true happiness is, and what it is, and where it is. 100% certain of that, because she showcased it perfectly. But again, no imposition there. So we have to, for those who want this freedom, they have to realize there is truth, there is freedom, there is reality. But how to get there is something that it has to develop without coercion, without imposition. We can voluntarily take on discipline. Just like if you want to get in shape, it's up to you. If you want to just run and get in shape by yourself, that's fine. If you want to hire a trainer, that's fine. If you want to do it in a group, that's fine. Whatever works for you, the end is what's important. The end is what is important. So if you want to use these means and that works for you, that is fine. If some people want organized religion, that is fine. If some want to be a maverick like myself, that is fine. If some want to do group study, that's okay. If one wants self-study, that's okay. All of that is okay. There are different ways. But there has to be at the heart of it, there has to be the wisdom. Wisdom has to be at the heart of a civilization. Spiritual wisdom has to be founded on this vast compassion and understanding of how it goes, and that each one must gain their own clarity. It has to be founded on that. If it's not, you're going to get a political, economic, cabal solution imposed with draconian laws and reprisals and punishments and pressures and all of that that the world is now in lockstep with. And at that point, you have a corpse. You have a corpse. And the world is dead at that point. It's dead to you. It no longer serves. It no longer helps you. It's not a helpful situation at all. And so, of course, you're going to look to sidestep. Of course, you're going to look for alternatives. Of course, you're going to look for options. And what I've been shown is that there are options. There will be. Now, I have not been given specific information about this, maybe simply because it's best for me, because I don't want to focus on the details, because the details are not very important. People keep telling me, well, how do we get there? How do we get there? How do we get there? Look, The fact is that the dreamer of the dream, one who knows they're the dreamer of the dream and has awoken from it, knows the dream is completely unnecessary, also can dream within that dream, but can dream in a helpful way. So that someone who is perfectly awake can literally manifest planets like instantly. They can manifest, transport to get to those planets like that instantly. It's all a dream. There's no process to go through for one who is perfectly awake to that. And it's perfectly in alignment with the true plan of salvation, of realization that this is only a hypothetical scenario. They can manifest planets that would be perfectly suitable for us, beautiful planets, and then manifest ways to take us there like that, instantly. Piece of cake for them. Not the slightest bit of trouble. That is a fact. I know that is an absolute fact. If that was necessary, and it may be very necessary coming up to do so. Very necessary. And I have seen that there is something like this. Now, is this true? I can't say 100% that it's true, that this will take place. I don't have certitude, absolute certitude about it. But I'm saying is, it is worth considering carefully and saying, have an open mind to it and saying, if it does happen, this could be a really good option, because the way the world is going now, it seems to be developing towards a utopia, but it is really going towards a dead end, a very bad dead end, because it is not based on the wisdom of those who have realized this is only a hypothetical scenario, it's only a dream. It is based on the intellect of those who have gone to Ivy League colleges, okay, those who have had an elite education. What is this education they're getting? What is it based on? Empirical materialism, Aristotelian logic, and on and on and on, which is not based, not even remotely close to true wisdom at all. And so what they see is they think they see a better way. Hey, let's make sure everything's equal. Equal results, equal time for this and that. That only causes depression. And the more you get that in the world, the more the world will simply want to die. They won't even see it, because it will be a collective depression. And then at some point there'll be desire for the whole planet to be destroyed. To tell you the truth of the situation, that will likely come about. This planet is likely to be destroyed. It will be melted down, as it were. Because the collective will of the planet will be suicidal, will say, we feel completely stuck and we don't understand why. Let's just end it all. You know, let's just end it. We're completely immobilized. We have to give equal time to this and this. We can't make a meaningful choice at all. We can't see any meaning at all anymore. And it'll be this ennui, this deep, deep mental ennui that grips the planet as a whole. You know, not just an individual, it will be something that is like amorphous and free-floating in the entire planet. And people will just feel like they're completely entrapped by it, and there's no way out whatsoever. And then they will collectively want the whole thing to end. And that can come about very fast, and the red flags for that developing are extremely strong, extremely strong. And I see it's virtually unavoidable at this point. And I certainly don't want to get trapped in that, and I'm sure many do not either. And this feeling of collective despair and meaninglessness can be so pervasive that if you're here on this planet at that time, you run the risk of getting sucked into that too. And thinking, yeah, I need to give equal time here because we don't know what is true. And saying that something is true is hurts the feelings of someone else who doesn't think it's true. And we can't have anything that hurts anyone's feelings at all. So let's mandate equal time for both truth and lies and set that in stone forever and forever and forevermore. And at that point, you have no choice but to feel a sense of meaninglessness and total confusion and despair. And it'll be dreadful, dreadful, dreadful. And if you know these ET groups that are involved with this planet, some of them actually have gone through that and have suffered extremely badly for that. And they're desperately trying to get free of it. They don't know how to get free of it. They don't know how to get free of it. They think the way to get free of it is through emotion or something like that. No, it's not. So they're still lost in delusion. And they're coming here and we're catching the virus from them of somehow not giving offense to anybody, equal time to everything. We've caught that virus in the world. The Greys are an example of that. And the Draconians are also have a way of trying to impose from top down, trying to impose everything on the planet, thinking that will develop more rapid results, which will be helpful. It's a sickness. The world has gone sick, really. And the extraterrestrials have had a lot to do with this, actually. They're very sick. Very, very sick. They've gone through this horrible ennui of collective despair, and they've had whole planets destroyed. You know, and they come to this earth and say, oh, you need to help us, you need to help us. But in trying to help them, we've caught the illness. It's like the colonialists coming to America and giving smallpox to the Indians. And some was inadvertent and some was not inadvertent. Sometimes we gave them blankets that were infected with smallpox to wipe them out. So some of these Greys, it was inadvertently we caught this disease from them, and others were imposing it on purpose, still believing that we just need to get the rest of the galaxy to do it the way we do it, and then everything will be solved. Well, they're just spreading their depression, they're just spreading their despair, they're just spreading their suicidal complex, their planetary destructive situation. They're just spreading it, and they've spread it to this planet. And that was all foreseen by some very awake beings. One of them was Jesus Christ, very awake, totally awake. And somehow through the Essenes, through some of those he worked through, somehow this message came down saying, this world will be, catch this virus. They knew all about it ahead of time. But it's happened all over the place. You know, you might call it a galactic virus or a universal virus that has spread. And we were told it's going to spread here. We're going to have contact with these aliens, and they're going to spread this virus throughout the world. And the world is going to conform itself to what they want, the way they have done it, which will result in this terrible planetary despair and planetary destruction, along with severe troubles, catastrophes, etc. And there's a way to sidestep it. There'll be a way, supposedly, the way they put it, is that Jesus will come back at some point and take those who want to leave to a place he has prepared for them. And again, I say that as far as Jesus preparing a place, he can do it like that, instantly, perfectly, flawlessly, no difficulty whatsoever. And as far as transportation there, same thing. Just like that, it'll just be there, flawless, not the slightest difficulty. So for me, I don't worry about the details. I don't worry about it at all. And he said, look, when the time comes, you'll know the way. Meaning, don't worry about the way. The way will be there. If that is true, if that does occur. And I'm saying, I've seen that something along those lines is going to occur. I don't really have the details of it. But it is necessary, because this sickness here on this planet, we have to realize we've caught the alien bug. We've caught their virus. we're so worried about contact with aliens, like, oh, they might bring some new illness or disease here, like AIDS or something, you know, some terrible. All the while, we don't realize that the virus they're bringing is this delusion of equal results, of spending equal time with both truth and lies. That is the virus they're bringing, a virus of depression. A virus of depression is what they have brought to this planet. And I caught that virus, actually, early on in my life. I was supremely depressed because I was trying to work with these extraterrestrials and the planet, and I was trying to figure out what's the best situation is, because I used to be very aware of the ETs and what they're doing here. And I caught this virus from them. Very bad, because they work through like the United Nations and the intellectual elites of this planet in various ways and means. And I was trying to work through that and trying to be on that level, seeing what can be done, how can I help. I ended up catching that virus, and I became supremely depressed, extremely suicidally depressed, horrible. And I've been able to work out of that, but it was extremely difficult. Thanks to Ananda Maima, Jesus Christ, Ramana Maharshi, and the other great teachers that have come to this planet, and teachings. and my own determination, I've been able to work out of that to the point now where I don't suffer from that type of depression. I have clarity now about the situation. The situation we're suffering from now is an alien virus. It is an alien virus, but we're not looking in the right place for it. It's an ideological virus. Okay? And we've already caught it. We've already caught it. And there's many people in this world that have caught it really bad. And those are the people, the leaders of the planet, the intelligentsia of this planet, those who, NGOs, large worldwide organizations, all these people have caught this virus very severely, and they're trying to impose it upon the entire planet. And you have a group of people in the United States who have been trying to stand up to this and saying, no, we don't want this because we trust more in what Christ told us. And we have a greater sense of freedom. We have an intuitive sense that this isn't right. We may not know what is right, but we have an intuitive sense that this definitely is not right. This imposition of equal results, equal time is going to be a disaster. And there are people in about half the country, United States, say, hey, wait a minute, this isn't right. This isn't right. There's something wrong. And then they're not able to explain it like I can. And they may be mistaken in various ways, but there is some deep-seated intuitive sense within, and they say, "Hey, let's be careful about going down this path. Let's be careful about it." And that should be respected. Actually, shouldn't be rejected. They shouldn't be scorned. Shouldn't be mocked. Which is going on now severely. The mocking is very severe, the scorn, and even the mind tricks, Orwellian mind tricks of saying, oh no, we're not trying to bully you. Oh no, we're not trying to get rid of you. Oh no, what do you, you're crazy to think we're doing. Oh no, no. You know, that's going on very strongly too. So it is a very nasty situation in the world right now because the world has caught this alien virus and they're denying it because they don't realize what happens. I know what happens. I know what happens for sure. And it is horrible. And if you talk to these aliens, if you communicate with them, they'll tell you that, yeah, there's some honest ones. I mean, they're not all bad. Not all aliens are really terrible. That doesn't mean they're not carrying this virus. They're trying to get well, some of them, but they don't know how to get well. And so they contaminate you in your attempt to help them. They end up contaminating you. It's like you're a therapist, like an insane asylum, and you get some people, some patients that come in who are really badly insane, and they grab a hold of you and say, please help me, please help me, you got to help me. And you say, okay, I really want to be helped. And in your effort to help them, they suck you into their madness. That can happen. That really can happen. Transference can go in that direction. If you're not a good enough therapist, you can be sucked into their madness. You have to be very careful of that. So I got sucked into that madness, but all the while remembering that, hey, I'm supposed to be helping them. I'm a therapist. I know the answer. And yet they have somehow confused me. They somehow confused me. And they couldn't help me. They could not help me. The ETs cannot help us get free of their own sickness because they don't even know how to get free of themselves. They really don't know. They're clueless. They're really clueless. So they're asked for help, and yet they don't even know what kind of help they need. The insane don't know how to be helped. They don't know what kind of help they need. They don't. So some kind of tough love at some point is kind of necessary until you get to the point where you realize, hey, wait a minute, I really do need some help, and I'm able to at least help myself a little bit get to that point, then more freedom is possible. But tough love is necessary at some point. So I know the depression the world is headed to. I know how severe it can get, and it can get severe beyond the help of any medicine possible. It really can go beyond the scope of medicine helping you, the depression. It really can. You can know there's no medication that can help you. You can get to a point of depression where you feel it's all so meaningless that it doesn't matter what medication you take. It won't cure you. It won't help you because you literally feel it's totally meaningless. And the situation from the standpoint that you're in is totally meaningless. That's the problem. That is the problem. Because you're accepting a false premise that somehow you're supposed to give equal time to truth and lies, and that's the answer, and that if you don't, that's not fair, or some craziness like that. And it's the whole point of teachers like myself to try to explain this to you, try to clarify, try to help give you, at least give you a sense that there's some clarity somewhere. Even if you can't follow it, if you get a sense, there is some clarity somewhere. It is possible. That is super helpful, super helpful. And through these many videos, hundreds of videos, I've tried to just share this clarity with you to show you it is possible. It is absolutely possible. And it's hard to drink it all in one drink. But you can, when you go on this path, clarification will start happening for you. And suddenly you'll catch a belief in its lies. You'll see, that's not reason. That's plausibility. There's something wrong, totally wrong with that. And you'll catch it again and again and again. You'll start catching it. Hundreds and hundreds and thousands of times you will start catching it and seeing. Gradually start seeing through it, and the depression lifts. It lifts. But a planetary depression has got to be sidestepped. Has got to be sidestepped. So I'm getting more and more, the clearer I see the situation, the more adamant I'm becoming about sidestepping it. And I'm going in that direction more and more. Because I've been there and done that on that depression. Let me tell you, you've got to sidestep it. You've got to. Because if it becomes a planetary depression, which is where it's headed, that is truly terrible. And you will want to end up not only destroying yourself, not only destroying everybody else, but wanting to destroy the whole planet, wanting to destroy the whole universe, the whole thing. That's not the path to salvation. I'm not advocating destruction of anything. I'm advocating the overlay of everything. That's totally different than destruction of everything. I don't want any part of the universe to be destroyed or altered in any way. Let it be exactly as it is. Zero destruction. Because the overlay will overlay it perfectly, and you'll be totally satisfied with the overlay and saying, the overlay is a witness to truth. It is a witness to reality. It is a witness to the fact that reality can never be changed. And therefore, this entire universe is completely unnecessary. And if it's unnecessary, why do I even need to worry about changing it? The very act of trying to get results in it shows that I believe it's meaningful. Don't need any results other than us to see that we don't need any results. That's the one result we need. But it's not in the universe. It's coming from freedom from the universe. The idea of not needing, that reality cannot be changed. It's coming from that. So a planetary depression, which is what's coming, and I'm telling you, it is coming, and I can see it. I've been there. I've done that. I'm like ahead of the times, which is the whole point of me being here, is I went through all this ahead of time, so I've been able to clear it up ahead of time, so I'm able to give you some sense of freedom, clarity, and you know it is possible. So you can say, hey, you can feel something coming. What is it? It is planetary depression, a sense of severe meaninglessness, severe. Very severe, beyond anything you have any idea about, can possibly imagine. I don't talk about my depression that I went through because it was so terrible I don't even want to talk about it. I don't even want to think about it. I don't want to send my mind back to those times at all. It is simply like, turn the page, you know, it was that terrible. You don't sit around and say, yeah, I was depressed. No. It was terrible beyond any. The only thing that kept me going was I couldn't believe how terrible it was. It was beyond belief how terrible it was. And I said, wow, this is kind of has a sort of a, its own fascination. How can anything be so terrible? is what kept me going. I said, gosh. I said, I don't want to kill myself because this is so terrible. It's interesting. It's interesting me. Why is it so terrible? How can it be? It seems impossible. How could this arise at all? Where did it come from? Where did anything so terrible come from? It became a cause in itself to find out where this came from and unravel this. And I've been able to do that thanks to the great help of my spiritual mentors. Because without them, there's no way. I don't think there's any way I could have done it. Theoretically, I could have. Practically, I could not have. I would have succumbed in some way for sure. Because what's coming on the world is nasty, nasty, nasty. And don't think you're smart enough to deal with it. That is so important. Believe me, I was a genius and very smart. And my intellect was totally overmatched by this depression. Totally. I was helpless intellectually in the face of this. Helpless. The intellect was like a piece of speck of dust compared to this depression. What saved me was inner clarity, the voice of reason, which is totally beyond the intellect, and it's even beyond this depression. It's beyond this universe. That's what saved me. And those mentors who told me, trust in this clarity, trust in this reason. That's what they said. Trust in it. They said, you have to trust in this, otherwise you'll never make it out. And which is true. If you rely on the intellect, you can never make it out of this depression. You cannot. You cannot. And what you will do is you will try to spread the depression. You won't realize you're spreading it. You'll spread the contagion. And you'll think that's escaping it. It's only making it worse. Imagine if you have a depression and you spread it to others. How is that making your depression better? It's making it worse because now others around you are also depressed. So these grays that are spreading their contagion, they think they're getting healing. They're not. They're making it worse. Now they're going to have a whole planet that's got the same terrible depression that they do and want the whole planet to be destroyed. So they're deluded in thinking that they're making the situation better. They're not. They're making it worse. And there are some who think they can solve the whole problem by claiming there's no such thing as ETs. You know, stick their head in the sand. Say, oh, how can we be depressed? How can we get in this problem? Contagion. There's no such thing as ETs, so we can't get love. That is just empty bravado. Empty bravado. I'm 100% certain there are ETs. There's no question about it. And most of the planet realizes that there are. And it is foolhardy to not vet the ETs, not vet them, not recognize what's really going on here. It's very foolhardy, very foolish. And they buy us off by entertainment, giving us, you know, special effects, all this digital stuff and entertaining them. And they have ways of buying us off, saying, hey, don't vet us. We're nice people. We're not bringing you any problems. Look at what we're bringing you. That's like the settlers in America saying to the Indians, hey, we're great people. Don't worry about us. Look at these glass beads we brought from Venice. You know, Venetian beads, aren't these beautiful? Here, we'll give them to you. All we ask is you let us stay here and live in your land and deed your land over to us. And we're nice people. You know, we're not here to do any evil. That's what they told them. And Indian said, wow, these glass beads are really beautiful. We'll trade them, you know, we'll make them currency. Well, these are wonderful. Wow, thank you. Same thing. And then the contagion was spread here through the Americas of commercial materialism and commercialism in some ways. In other ways, some positive things came about here. But the ETs are trying to tell the world, hey, we're not any problem for you. Look what we're bringing you. Better entertainment. Got smartphones, a bunch of apps, you know, tweets, you can now tweet. Yeah, why do we need, we don't want to vet these guys, you know, these guys and gals that are coming, we want to vet them. They gave us tweeting. Yeah, and the price you pay, what do the Indians pay? Smallpox, wipe out, genocide, right? What is the price that the world's going to pay? Planetary depression, meaningless, this horrible, horrible feeling that comes upon you like a ghost out of nowhere. You don't know where it's coming from. You don't. You can't find any origin for it. It's very difficult. And when you're in that situation, you're gripped by it, and you feel like you'll never get free of it. That's the feeling I had. The feeling why it's so terrible is you literally feel you'll never get free. There is no way to get free of it. You're stuck here forever. That's how you feel. And imagine the torment that you feel, because that's literally what you feel. So imagine how you will feel feeling that way, that you have the sense of total meaninglessness and you'll never escape it. That's your reality. That is where you'll always be. That's how you feel. And it's absolutely horrible. And that's what we're headed to. Lickety-split. Lickety-split. And everyone has big smiles on their faces because they say, well, look at the big screen entertainment. You know, the guys got bought off by pornography. Right? Look at all the pornography. Look at all the great music. Look at all the great drugs. Look at all the beautiful, sexy women in the world. The guys got bought off. You know, the women got bought off by materialism. And look at all the clothes. Look at all the shoes you can have. Look at all the appliances. Look at all the homes. Look at all the wonderful cars. Look at all the vacations. Look at all the power you can have. The control, the manipulation. You be a goddess. And look at all this stuff. You know, it's like, wow. You know, this is, look at all the entertainment. We all got bought off. We got bought off. We got bought off by the ETs. Absolutely did. Absolutely did. And of course, there's a whole bunch of business people in the world who made a fortune on this, saying, what do we care? As long as we get rich, what do we care? Yeah, we'll be all rich. Yeah, you'll be rich and depressed. I guarantee you, all the money in the world won't make you feel the slightest bit better when you have this, when this depression grips you. You can be a multi-trillionaire and you won't feel any better whatsoever. In fact, you'll probably feel even worse because you realize your money, all that money is useless to you. Useless. So, you know, you get in bed with the devil, it's a bad deal, isn't it? Really bad deal. Sure, there's all sorts of people in the Silicon Valley who are super wealthy. Super wealthy because they made money off of the whole digital technology thing, and now they're marketing all this stuff. You know, that Xbox game made $500 million on the first day. There's people getting wealthy hand over foot. All over the world, there are people getting fabulously wealthy now simply because they got in bed with the ETs and said, hey, yeah, we'll distribute this stuff for you. We'll manufacture it. We'll go along with all the technology that you gave to us, and we reversed engineered, and you saw that we got quickly and works for us all, and we'll make all the stuff under your guidance, and then we'll distribute it, make sure all the kids, everybody has it. And then they'll be so busy doing that, they won't even realize what's happening in the world. They won't even realize that they're heading pell-mell into this deep, 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 dark depression. Very dark depression. Why? Well, because they go shopping. You know, why should they worry? I bet they go shopping and just buy all this stuff, and the women can just go on shopping sprees like crazy, soaking them in, and you can throw it on a credit card, and then you can live the life of Riley, and it seems like a utopia almost, doesn't it? But what a Tinseltown utopia it is. What an utterly deceptive thing it is. It's just glass beads, and behind that comes the smallpox, as it were, becomes this devastating depression. Devastating. And we see people talk about economic depression. That just maybe is a foreshadowing. The real depression is the spiritual depression of meaninglessness. Of so much confusion, you don't see any meaning. You think you have to give equal to truth and lies, and then your life, you feel the sense of meaninglessness, because that is truly meaningless. And yet you literally feel this is your salvation, because that's the salvation that belief gives to you. That's beliefs telling you how to adapt to this so-called hypothetical new reality. That's its advice. That's its salvation. That's what it tells you. Give equal meaning to truth and lies. Ultimately wants to give you all meaning to lies, but he can't do that. So he says, well, let's settle for equal truth to truth and lies, which is totally meaningless, which gives you this dark, 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 dark depression, which I call this world is headed towards a dead end. That is the dead end, because once you get into that depression on a planetary scale, the planet is cooked, absolutely cooked at that point. And therapists, what can a therapist do at that point? Really, the time for therapy has been the last 100 years or so, last couple hundred years, ahead of time, before this happened. Why do you think Anandamaya Ma, Ramana Maharshi, Meher Baba, Punjaji, etc., etc., whoever you look up to, there are other ones, Krishnamurti, Yogananda, etc., 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 why did they come into the world when they did? Because they knew this was coming, and they knew they had to reach us now, because if they didn't, it would be too late. It would be too late. So they did reach us. So we're in good shape. That's the ultimate happy ending, is the fact we're in good shape. We are in good shape. Those who have listened to the truth, you're in good shape. If you can listen to these videos, you're in good shape. You really are in great shape. Because you just imagine if you had not listened to any of this. So I tell you, the last my lifetime, 56 years, and before that, when these great teachers were here, was a great, 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 great time. And of course, Jesus for 2,000 years, Buddha, Muhammad, various teachers, were giving out something that was very beneficial. And some have their favorites, and they may think the others are not so good, et cetera, which is fine. If you want to feel that way, it's okay, no problem. But the deep-seated, there's some kind of deep-seated intuition and knowing, like there's something coming in the world that's going to be very bad, and you got to sidestep it. Very important. And that sense of that is a very healthy skepticism, very healthy awareness. Be aware. And when you see something, you say, whoa, wait a minute. Let me be open to the highest truth. And when you feel that way, you're going to find some truth. You're going to find some good truth, and you're going to be in a good shape now. So we're in good shape, very good shape. I've already, for all intents and purposes, overcome this depression. Already overcome it. Not 100%, but it is certainly trending in that direction very strongly. And I feel will continue to trend. Not that I don't get despondent. It's different, though. Despondent means I don't see how I can possibly keep functioning in this world just simply because my circumstances, my material circumstances, are very, very thin ice. And the ability to speak out without reprisal is on thin ice. The ability just, you know, to safely say what you want to say in the world is on thin ice. There's a lot of things that make the future extremely problematical for me. So I look at that and I say, wow, how do I chart a course to that future? It just doesn't seem possible. But that is not the same as the sense of severe meaninglessness and depression. It's not the same at all. Because I bounce back very quickly from this and I say, hey, let's look at our options. Okay, let's not allow this to make us feel we have no options. Let's just look and see if we can find them. And I have the energy to do it, the spirit to do it. Which is very different than depression. Depression, you are knocked out. You feel you are stuck forever. And you have no capability to look at any option. You feel you see the options, and the options are meaningless, and that's it. There are no others, and you are stuck there forever. That's how you feel. That's how you see it. That is how you see it. So that has been largely dismissed and overcome in my case, and I will continue along that process, as I do every day, to keep pushing the advantage and keep giving, sharing this with others, and encouraging them, giving them heart, giving them courage that, yeah, it is absolutely possible to go away from this deep, dark depression that is coming upon the planet. Absolutely. Set your sights on that. Say, I'm not going to go into that pressure. That's a waste of time for me. I know there is such a thing as divine reason that will clarify for me this false logical plausibility. Once that's clarified, the whole edifice of this delusion can then be easily seen through. You don't have to demolish it. You can just see right through it. You don't have to destroy anything. You don't have to attack anything here. I don't attack anything. I'm not out there trying to destroy anyone or anything. I'm just seeing right through it, saying, this is just a hypothetical scenario. This is completely meaningless. I don't need to get any results one way or the other here. Don't need any results. Can see it. Just let everything be as it is then. Why do you have to change anything? Why do you have to attack anything? Why do you have to, you know, make the world a certain way or that way? But in saying that, of course, you don't want to go into the deep, deep, dark depression where you think you're stuck in this meaninglessness. That's horrible. I don't want that result for anybody, so I'm speaking up and saying you don't want that. That is definitely don't want that result. But you're not going to get free of that by trying to attack something in the world. No, that doesn't work. You get free of it by trusting this voice of clarity within you. That's how you get free. You have to have some faith. Faith, you have to have some trust in this inner voice. And how do you get that? Partially by you just exercising this voice of clarity, listening to it, paying attention. Just pay attention, and somehow you'll start seeing stuff. So, whoa, I didn't see that before. That's how it started with me. I just said, hey, I didn't see that before. I missed that. How did I miss that? And then I said, how did I miss that? It was so obvious, and I didn't even see it before. I said, wow. And then I'd see a bunch of little other things and say, oh, I never saw that before either. How interesting. I wonder why I never saw that before. And it gradually develops that way. Very smooth, very organic. That very sense of continuity is very smooth. The whole path had a tremendous sense of continuity to it for me. No breaks in the continuity, really. There were times when I'd go around a turn and I'd say, wow, here's a whole different perspective. But there was still a sense of continuity that I'm on this path, on this road, and I got used to making greater and greater, faster and faster steps forward. But that also was smooth. There were no breaks in continuity on my path at all. That is something I can share with you. So it's not some scary thing in that way. It is not. You just start noticing more and more and more. So I'm sure that many of you have noticed a lot. Noticed a lot. So you're in good shape. But don't rest on your laurels. Do not rest on your laurels. Because this virus, this contagion on this planet is severe. And the temptations, the trinkets, are becoming ever more gaudy in this world. They really are. My gosh. And they're being wrapped up in all this pretty wrapping, and pretty bows are being put upon them. And the marketing is becoming more and more tempting and attractive to it all. And it's just like it make your head swim. I don't even go out shopping anymore. I really don't. If I can snag something on eBay, maybe I will. I don't even go into stores anymore, really, if I can help it. No, I don't. I do not. I had my time where I did, and I vetted the whole thing. At a time, that's all I did was just wander in and out of stores and shopping, and it just got the whole experience. And then at some certain point, I realized, hey, that's enough. Enough is enough. And now I don't feel any being deprived about not shopping or going to stores at all. Forget it. It's the hard sell is on, I'm telling you. It is really on. And it's being more and more glamorized, et cetera, et cetera. Those are the trinkets that misdirect your attention away from what's really happening, from the contagion, not realizing you're being contaminated. And not listening to this voice within that's telling you, hey, you're being contaminated. You need to listen to this voice of clarity right now. Instead, say, well, I'll do that later. Why? Close the voice of clarity says, why? Why not now? And you say, because there's a really great show on. Really great show. I can't miss this show. This is the final episode. Or this is the beginning episode. Or this is the episode where this happens. Or these are the finals. Or they're calling it down to the last four contestants. All this stuff is by design. This is all part of the design of the extraterrestrials here and those who work for them. Part of that design. Okay. Which is part of the design of belief, actually. Part of the design of this hypothetical scenario is you say, yeah, I'll listen to this voice of reason, but not right now because somebody is trying to get the right answer to this trivia question, and I gotta pay attention to that. And so you delay step by step by step by step by step. You choose to put off listening to this voice of clarity right now and say, I'll do it just as soon as this is over. And as soon as this is over, you find something else that's important. You say, hey, this is an award show. This only happens once a year. Yeah, but how many award shows are there? They're continuous now. I mean, you can see the award show almost every day of the year. So if you say it's only once a year that they have this, and then the next day, there's another award, but it's a different one. It's a different award show. They only have this different one once a year. You can fill up 365 days of the year now watching award shows virtually, right? And they have all these game shows and trivia shows, etc. You say, all these shows where there's always something on TV, right? Always something on, or in the magazine, something, whatever it is, that you say, this is a one-time thing. I'm only doing this as one time. There's something to fill up every moment of your time that way now. So you don't listen to the voice of clarity at all. You put it off, say, postpone it. And before you know it, you'll be so contaminated that you'll be so confused, that your life you'll be feeling so meaningless that you'll start getting into heavy medications to try and deal with this. And your life will be wrapped up in medication and various types of therapy. And you'll just try to sedate yourself and watch more of these shows. And you'll feel at that point that the voice of clarity is some kind of enemy, that it's the cause of this somehow. You'll get completely confused and you won't know what it's talking about. And then you'll get into this deep, dark depression. Very bad situation. And this is something I've spoken out from the time I was born here. I was warning people about this nonstop. Nonstop. Don't pay attention to the entertainment or the news or any of that stuff. Pay attention to the voice of clarity within you, because that's the only way you're going to get free. And I'm witness to the fact you can get free. It does work. That is the way that works from this severe depression. It works. The other ways don't work. I tried other ways. They don't work. They don't work. Only this voice of clarity that knows the truth is sufficient to unravel the seemingly impossible, unravelable, I can't even say that. That's a tough one. Unravelable conundrum that seems to be an impossible pit to escape from, an impossible pit to escape from. It's not impossible. But your intellect doesn't know how to escape from it. Doesn't have a clue. Never will. Never will. And we've been worshiping the intellect. There's another thing. It is, we're grown up, and if we're intelligent, we get into school, and our aim is college, etc. We spend all our time studying, trying to get good grades, and when the voice of clarity says, hey, listen to me, I have something very important to tell you, we say, okay, but not yet. I have to get this good grade. I need to get good grades to get in this better school. I need to be the top of my class. I need to get into a good college. I need to get a good degree. I need to get a good career. And this whole time, no one listens to the slightest bit to this voice of clarity because they're listening to the intellect. The intellect says, I'm more important because I can get you a good life. What the voice of intellect is really going to get you is this deep depression. That's not a good life. It is a horrible life. It is horrible beyond any possible description. The depression they went through, there's no way you can describe the horribleness of it. It cannot describe it. Indescribably horrible. That's what the intellect ultimately gets you. That is what it gets you. And so I said, like in seventh grade, I believe it was, I completely stopped paying any attention to education. I said, that's it. I see what's going on. This is going to ruin me. It's going to kill me. It's already got me so confused that I'm in a bad state, and it got worse and worse and worse. Almost did kill me. And I said, that's it. And I started listening to the voice of clarity at that time, which is what ultimately saved me. So the intellect is just a tool of belief. It's just another hypothetical. It's just part of the hypothetical. It's as if the voice of clarity and truth is going to be replaced by the intellect. In other words, in this so-called new reality, it's the intellect that rules. It knows how to live within this changed reality. It's the guidance. It's the God. It's the knower. It's the knower of the known within this so-called new reality. But it's only a hypothetical scenario, and it doesn't know that. It doesn't know that. Intellect does not know this is a hypothetical scenario and cannot know it, cannot appreciate it, cannot get past it, cannot dismiss it. Because the intellect is supposedly the knower of the known within this hypothetical scenario. How can it dismiss it? It would be annihilation to the intellect. The intellect fears that it's annihilation because it doesn't realize that there's anything beyond this hypothetical scenario at all. So it can't possibly guide you out of it. It can only guide you into this impossible conundrum, seemingly impossible conundrum of meaninglessness. That's where it guides you. So I said, hey, no mas, I'm not listening to the intellect anymore. And my grades started slipping, and ultimately I dropped out of college because I had no more interest. I was just not putting any effort into it whatsoever. Maybe I'd show up for a test. Maybe I was actually too sick at the time to even show up for a test. I was so ill from this depression at that time. I literally was physically unable to show up for a test, and I flunked the class. Which was funny because it was a music appreciation class, and who could appreciate music more than I? I'm an aficionado, and I flunked the class because I was so ill I couldn't even move out of my chair to go into the university to take the test. And at that point, then I was, you know, I had to simply go in bed and rest for a long, long time. It's horrible. But I was also listening to the voice of reason and saying, wow, this is pretty scary. This is a nasty situation. And I was fortunate in 1978 to come across A Course in Miracles. And when I came across that, and I read it, I looked at it, and I said, aha, this is what I knew was coming. And I know I felt a sense of certainty that I'm going to get well. That was the greatest time imaginable. Imagine feeling you're stuck in this horrible meaninglessness forever, that you're going to be in this eternal torment forever. And then coming across something and you see it, you say, oh my gosh, I'm now positive I'm going to get free of it. That is the feeling I had, literally. I knew I was going to get free. at that point. I was positive. I said, oh my gosh. I knew it was going to take a while, a lot of effort, but I was going to get free of it. And that was just an unbelievable feeling. Incredible. Very intense life. I've led very intense, and that was super intense to just recognize, hey, I'm going to get free of this. I know it's going to be difficult, but I'm positive that I'm going to find this. I'm going to escape from this. I'm going to escape from what seemed to be the inescapable situation. I knew it. I knew it. And it's turned out to be true. That was a big enough boost to do that. It really was. The situation now, as far as a big boost goes, it's really too late in the game to start out a path, as it were. There is a time for a harvest. You know, there's a time to sow and a time to reap, as it is said in traditional terms. And there's a time to start the path. There's a time to finish it. And the boost that comes for starting had to come at a certain time. Right now, for someone to just to start out who's just beginning, that is a tall order. I'm not saying it's impossible at all, but I would say the tools to do that are already here. But as far as a new big boost coming on the scene, that would have to be something different. It could not be a written curriculum at this point. It could not. There are written curriculums that are already here. Various people use different curriculums. Some use like various holy books, and some New Age books, some like A Course in Miracles, its own category. So people use different teachings as far as book form. But those are already here. They're already here. So for another big boost to come, it would have to be a different type than the written. It cannot be written words at this point. It would have to be an actual ambassador of certitude would have to come on the scene. Or several ambassadors of certitude would have to come on the scene. Beyond words. That would be beyond words. That is the big boost that would have to happen now to help us, to help with the harvest. The harvest means simply those who know that they're going to get free of this severe depression, this contagion, and are willing to get free and are willing to do the work to do it. They decide, I'm gonna go in that direction. That's the harvest. That's the harvest. And they sidestep this planetary depression. They sidestep it. Possibly by going to another place. Possibly. There may be other options, I'm not sure, but it is certainly possible that will happen. And to do that, you need a big boost. You need some ambassadors of certitude who you realize, hey, this one is certain, truly certain, not intellectually certain, not plausibly certain, but actually really certain. And your intuition sees that perfectly well and says, this one is absolutely certain. And then you know they're trustworthy. You know they're trustworthy at that point. At that point, you know they're trustworthy because they can see the entirety of this hypothetical scenario. The entirety of it. And they're not bound by any of it. And they can literally do any miracle they want to within it. Anything that's necessary, they can do, actually. And you truly are safe within their care at that point. Really are. And as long as you don't see it as entrapment, then it's fine. It's fine for you. The intellect will say it's entrapment. Of course the intellect will. But we are at a point where we give more credence to the voice of clarity within and the intuitive knowingness than we do to the intellect. We give more credence to it. So the intellect will say, this is entrapment. We say, no, it isn't. Now, the forms of entrapment come from intellect. And the intellect is trying to distract us from that. I mean, the form of entrapment is taking place on this planet right now, where we're being entrapped in this horrible depression as we go along the road laced with all the superficial, cheap thrills. And now they're even introducing legal drugs, which is to embellish the entrapment. Very, very distracting. The voice of clarity can't really operate when you're high. Not really at all. It gives you a false sense of clarity. The drugs give you a false sense of clarity. You think, hey, I'm seeing stuff really good now. And when the drugs wears off, it's like, whoa, what happened to it? What happened to it? I don't see anything at all right now. What's going on? And you feel confused. It brings a sense of confusion. And what it does, it embellishes music. It embellishes sensory stuff. It embellishes cheap thrills. It embellishes all sorts of various things. And so they seem even more distracting. So by legalizing those, it's just saying, wow, the game is really on now. It is really on. Because that just really greases the skids, actually. Greases the skids. Because it gives a temporary sense like, oh, I only need to use this drug and I can get free of the depression. No, you're not. Not at all. Because you're not listening to the voice of clarity, which is the only way to get free of this contagion. What it is, it gives you kind of like a, it's like caffeine giving you like some false sense of energy because it revs you up in a certain way. And you think you're Superman or Superwoman, but you're not listening to the voice of clarity there because you're saying, hey, I can get so much done. Why should I listen to the voice of clarity? Because the voice of clarity is wanting me just to sit here quietly, not do anything. And here I've got all this energy. Why don't I go out and change the world? So it's a supreme distraction too. Stimulants are supreme distraction. Drugs of any kind are extreme distractions, actually. And you end up getting into situations you wouldn't get into otherwise. You really do. So those are super bad trends from the standpoint of getting free. Super bad trends. Most of the people I know that were into drugs are still into them in one form or the other. Very difficult to get free of it, because you waste your time. You don't really, you say, why should I listen to the voice of clarity when I can just get high? Why should I? Why should I make the effort? It's much easier just to get high, right? It doesn't require you sitting there quietly and really looking within and being the courage to face your fears and to examine stuff from all angles and really use your mind in the right way. It doesn't require that. I mean, it's hard work. Spiritual path is hard work. It's tough. Get high is easy. Just pop a pill or whatever. Plenty of ways to get high easily. Easy, fast, easy way. And then you think, hey, I'm in an altered state. This is great. This this is a departure from meaninglessness. Ah. All the while you're being led into meaninglessness. All the while. You don't see it. You don't see it. And you try to drown that feeling of kind of dread. I say, whoa, I don't want to go down this path. You drown it by getting high or by energized, getting super energized, saying, it doesn't matter what path I'm going down. I can rearrange the whole doggone world. I'm Superman or woman, and I can rearrange anything. I can remodel anything. I don't like the house, remodel it. And tomorrow, if I don't like it, I'll just remodel the whole thing again. You got so much energy. You say, what the heck? I'll throw out all the furniture. I'll sell it all on Craigslist, and I'll buy a whole new set of furniture, and I'll do it today. I'll do it today. So I'll just keep remodeling. There's no problem. I got all the energy in the world. They start getting super tired. I just drink some energy. Just keep pounding energy drinks. Just keep pounding energy drinks. And you say, well, I don't have to listen to the voice within, because anything I don't like, I'll just remodel. Well, this depression you get into, there's no remodeling it. And you say, uh-oh. At some point, uh-oh. I can't remodel this. I don't know how to remodel this. I'm overmatched. I'm overmatched. And then the voice of clarity is the only way out. If you listened to the voice of clarity all along, you wouldn't have gotten into that situation. I got into it because I, out of compassion, wanting to help the world, and compassion can be a dangerous thing. If it's not wise compassion, it can be a very dangerous thing. And I actually tried to get the ETs off the back of the world by trying to deal with them. And that caused me to get that contagion, to catch that contagion by trying to prevent them from coming here in the first place and contaminating the world. I ended up getting contaminated, kind of on the front lines, as it were. And, you know, when you're on the front lines, you run the risk of severe problems. Because I knew they were bad news. They were bad news. Really bad news. And yet they're very intellectual. So I tried to deal with them on this intellectual level, you see. And that's what caused me to get too wrapped up in my own intellect, or in the intellect, by dealing with them on this intellectual level. Because you can't deal with them on an intuitive, clarity, reasoned level, because they don't know what that is. So I tried to deal with them on an intellectual level. I became super intellectual. I was like incredibly intellectual. And I could talk as good as any intellectual on this planet. And I in order to try to talk to these ETs and say, hey, you know, leave us alone, let us, this is what we're doing here, let it be, you know, and try to explain to them and discuss with them, etc., on the subtle levels, while I was asleep on the subtle levels, intuitive levels, I used to have vision where I could actually see that their spaceships, everything that was going on with the ETs, just be able to see that. And I had a heightened perception. And so by doing that, I got too wrapped up in the intellect, which then enabled me to get contaminated by them and this severe depression. So I know exactly what's going on this planet on a macro scale. Mine was on a micro scale, but on a macro scale, that is what is taking place on this planet. The benefit is that in getting wrapped up in it at that time, I've been able to get having the time to work on it to get free of it. So I'm now able to share this information with the world. So that is a great benefit, actually. And I didn't succumb, at least not yet. There have been many times when I almost did, and yesterday was one of them. Really, I'll tell you, that was scary. I literally could feel a potent type of illness gripping my nervous system and body, and I realized, hey, if this continues on, I'll be dead very, very soon. And somehow I did a video about tackling this very deep issue of culling the population of the planet, and I was able, and somehow that pushed the whole thing back, and I had the courage to do that, and today I felt fine, and I have tremendous energy today and spirit today. I don't feel this. I know it's still lurking, but I was able to push it back, which is a good thing, because I was worried there. I knew I was going to push it back, but it was still quite worrisome, really. It's like, I felt like the kind of thing I could be dead within like a month or so. That's how I kind of felt. And now I feel like I can, you know, I'm able to keep going if I can stay at this. But the situation is getting worse in the world. So, you know, the hounds of hell are at our heels, really. And when they start, you know, being able to sink their teeth into you, that's a scary thing. And, you know, right now I'm outrunning them a little bit, but they're still at my heels for sure. Because I'm saying things that the ETs think isn't the way to be healed. See, they're insane. They don't know the way to be healed. They think the way to be healed is, again, follow the intellect, which leads them right into the depression. They're actually, again, making their situation worse, which is what I tried to explain to them, because they're making this whole planet depressed, and that's just going to, they're going to look around and say, oh my gosh, you're all depressed too. And I'll, so then I feel like even worse. They're making it worse. They're really making it worse, and yet they think they're making it better. They're attacking religion severely, which is just the intellect trying to exert its authority over the whole situation. Because within religion, there are currents of wisdom, even though things have gotten distorted, badly distorted, and they've been turned into ways of worshiping, belief, et cetera, which you expect on this planet. Of course, that's going to happen. Anonymous Ma said that very few people came to her for the purposes of, because of they love truth. Very few. Isn't that amazing? Amazing. She said, honestly, she told the truth. She really told the truth in a very kind way. She said, hey, some did, but not many. Most came because they wanted to somehow benefit their intellects and benefit their lives, their material situation. They wanted to see how to boost their intellects so they could get more in the world. And they didn't really come for love of truth. They weren't really willing to take that path. That's a pretty heavy indictment, actually. And it's, you know, it's factual. It's very factual. So, of course, the ETs have found a very fertile ground in this world for the intellect to expand the intellect. So the intellect's getting very, very robust here and very confident that it can impose its will upon the entire planet. Very confident. You have the intellectuals are in charge now. And they're demonizing those who have a healthy distrust for the intellect. They're demonizing them. And that's... there's a lot of pressure right now being brought to bear, and you can feel it. Oh boy, it is coming. The hounds of hell again. The pack of hounds are nipping at our heels, and they look back and their mouths are frothing. They're rabid. They're really rabid, and you don't want those rabid creature, you know, biting into your legs. And when they do, you start feeling contaminated, and you have to use your clarity and your courage to push that back, push it back and say, not now, not now. I've got more important work to do. I've got no time for that. But it's getting more difficult. We need a big boost. We need a big boost, because it is getting way more difficult. And it is frightening. For me to get hit like that was frightening, really, because I wouldn't have expected it like quite that hard, really. But it was very hard. I said, holy cow, the situation is deteriorating rapidly. As I knew it would, but when it hits you, it's still shocking. I said, after this election, this election will have consequences. After this election, I said, November, it is going to start to unravel. It's going to be problematical. And it has been. And this is what happened was, it started hitting me in my health, my physical viability. There was basically a demand, I not be here physically, is the demand. I not be here physically, because the intellect feels it cannot exert its authority over me. And the intellect doesn't like that at all. It's really furious about it. And so it's hard to stay here at this point, because the intellect wants its authority to be planet global, totally global, with no opposition. No real opposition. Because I give actually real opposition to the intellect, because I can run circles around it. But you know, the token opposition is allowed. Tokenism is of course allowed. Say, oh yeah, we got a minority in this country club. Sure we do. Intellect will say, oh sure, we've got some spiritual folks here. We got some spiritual teachers here. Sure, of course we do. But no one who can really run rings around the intellect, who can absolutely dismiss it like it's nothing. That the intellect will not allow. It is trying to shut that out from the physical plane entirely, which is why I got that death feeling in me. Very bad. And so it is becoming consequential. I told you this election would be very consequential. It's becoming extremely consequential, very fast. And December 21st is a very good deadline to have, which is, what is it? I don't know, 28 days away or something, or less than that. Less than that. How many days away is it? What is today? Is today the 27th? Let's say three more days, 20, 28, 29, 30. That's 3 days and 21. It's 24 days away, which is three weeks plus. It's only 3 weeks plus away. And we say, oh, not much could happen. Yes, it could. I mean, the way I got hit yesterday, I said, holy cow. You know, you get hit like that again. If you get hit harder, I mean, you could literally die. If I had gotten hit harder than that, I might have died even. It was amazing. So there is some kind of pressure being brought to bear on this planet right now to break the will of those who can stand up to the intellect, to break their will so that they will not be in any opposition here whatsoever, to truly break their will and to do it on the terms of the intellect. Now, when I say leave this planet, sidestep the whole situation, that's done on our terms. That's not done on the terms of the intellect. And if we want to stay here, we can stay here. We will do things our way, not the way the intellect tells me I have to do, but the intellect is insisting we have to do it its way, and there's no more ifs, ands, or buts. It's not asking us, it's telling us. That's the feeling I got. It wasn't like someone pressuring me, asking me, hey, you know, would you do this? I really want you to do this. No, it was someone telling me that you have to do this. You have no choice. This is what we are now decreeing. It was kind of, that kind of thing is like, the intensity was way, way more than I'm used to. Way more. And I was like getting dizzy, and I was losing my balance, and I was having trouble walking and feeling lightheaded and feeling like I'm losing control of my physical apparatus. I really felt that way, that there was something that was trying to break my ability to function through this body. It absolutely was. And right now I'm functioning through it fine, but not so fine yesterday, actually. I was able to, it was a battle, it was a battle. A real skirmish, as it were. But that's just maybe the first skirmish, you know. It could be some more severe ones coming up. So, the big boost is in order. It really is in order. It is super important. And Right now, I'm not able to give the big boost. I'm not. Maybe at some point I could. I don't know. I mean, eventually all of us will be able to. I don't know the timing of it. It is too difficult to determine such timing. But I would expect the big boost to come from those who have been awake for a long, long time. Because masters of the whole situation, who absolutely know the whole situation through and through and are completely familiar with the situation and are capable of literally manifesting infinite planets instantaneously. Whatever we need to manifest, they can manifest. And they're completely familiar with that, completely okay with doing that. They understand the whole situation perfectly, and they have complete familiarity with that situation. That is what you would expect at this time. That is what is really necessary. Not some neophyte. Some neophyte is helpful, but not to that extent. We are dealing with planetary situation, and we're not dealing with just our situation. We're dealing with a planetary situation even beyond this planet, with a galactic situation, really. We are dealing with the spread of a contagion that is a severe contagion, and that this planet is super sick with this contagion. And just like the Spanish influenza, it got so bad that it could sweep through entire towns and just decimate the entire town. It was a global contagion, and you weren't really safe anywhere, hardly anywhere on the globe at that time. So we are facing a global contagion. It's not just isolated to one person or second person, etc. No, it has gone global. It is truly viral at this point. And the intellect is now strutting around, feeling its swagger, really feeling that, hey, it's time to put the hammer down. And those who will not submit to the intellect tells us is the way should vacate this place immediately. That is the demand. That is the order that's going out. The intellect orders, it decrees, it signs executive orders. It doesn't go through legislators and everything. It says, it just decrees. It says, this is the way I want it. And if the legislature doesn't want it this way, I'll just write a executive order. That's how it works. And so it decrees those who are decided that they're not going to bend to the will of the intellect. That the decree is that they vacate the place right now. Vacate their bodies. Vacate their bodies. And I said, no, I will not do that. But it was a demand. It was a decree. That's how I felt. So that's coming on strong. It is coming on strong. The theme song I had back in August and September was a Brenda Lee's Coming On Strong. It is coming on strong, coming on strong. I can feel the heartaches coming on strong. That is really the situation now. And that is why I've been warning you so severely. Now you're starting to get maybe the gist of it. I seem to be too intense and maybe a little out there by warning so intensely, saying the situation is going to hit super hard and it's going to be terrible and you have to be ready ahead of time or else it's going to be terrible. Now you're getting the gist of it and realizing I was not in error about that. It's because you're getting decrees now. You're not being requested, you're getting decrees. And those decrees will become stronger and stronger, saying if you're not willing to go along the plan of the intellect, it is decreed that you must leave your body right now. Right in this minute, you must leave. And if you don't have the will to stand up to that and the clarity to stand up to it, you will find yourself, as it were, going into some kind of death spiral. You really will. I mean, I got the full sense of what it is. So what you need to do, we need to find the answer to this right away. We need the big boost right now. Right now we need it. And I'm going to get it for you. Some way we have to find it. Maybe you can find it too. Who knows who can find it? There's got to be, we have to have this consent. We have to give out a consent and say, hey, I consent to this. I consent to someone who's totally familiar with the entire situation. Totally familiar with it. To rally us, to rally our will and say, we will not vacate our bodies here. If we vacate it all, we'll vacate in our own way and maybe we'll take our bodies with us. We'll do it the way that the voice of reason and clarity tells us that we'll do it. To those who can manifest whatever we need to whatever we need, who can manifest it for us, who'll do it in safety. We'll do it our way. We'll do it our way. We will not accept your decree. And 15 years ago, I had a dream that showed me the future. I had a number of dreams, actually, that showed, and one of those was that I would have a gun to my head, and I would, the decree was I had to die right now. And it was literally under the administration of, at that time, when I, during the dream of the 44th president of the United States would be the one who would be, at that time, who would be pushing this whole thing. And that's what we have, 44th president of the United States right now. And a gun was put to my head, and they said, you must decide, agree to die right now. And it was a horribly terrifying situation for me. And I almost buckled. Almost succumbed to it, and consented to my death, and I was able to suddenly catch myself and suddenly turn around and say, no, I will not. I don't give you any permission. I do not consent to it. And the guy pressuring me was like stunned, completely stunned. He said, what are you talking about? I said, no, I will not. I says, I do not give you my consent. You do not have my consent. I will not consent to my death. And he backed away. He backed away, shaking, like, whoa, who is this guy? You know, what is going on? And there was someone else, a handler, that was actually higher up than him, was screaming at him with fury. He said, what are you doing? This guy's got to die. And he said, no, I cannot. I cannot kill him. I cannot. I'm not able to. And this handler off to his left was absolutely furious with him. Totally enraged, says, you didn't kill him. I told you to kill him. You didn't do it. I told you to get his death. You didn't do it. You failed. What are you doing? They said, no. I'm going to re-educate him instead. I'm not going to kill him. I'm going to re-educate him. He'll consent to that. And I consented to that just because I was so glad to be alive. And then suddenly I realized what happened was one of the perfect teachers, a teacher, a pastor of certitude, I was walking down the street. And I saw them. I said, oh my gosh, I'm going with them. And I suddenly went to their side under their protection and went in with them. And those who were taking me to re-education were absolutely furious with me. They were so mad. You can't believe how mad somebody can get. They were just enraged, screaming and raged. They were out of their, they were out of their minds with rage towards me and the teacher that, the big boost who gave me the big boost came along, and I said, no, I'm going with this big boost. See you later. No re-education. I don't consent to that either. And they couldn't believe that anyone could stand up their authority, because they believe they are the ultimate authority. And here's someone else who dismisses their authority. They could not deal with it rationally. They lost all sense of rationality at that point. Totally. They became completely irrational. Just it was frightening. That is what is happening right now. Literally, right now, there is this decree going out that those who don't want to go along with the agenda of the intellect have to vacate their bodies. That is a decree that's going out. And I told you it's going to happen, and it's already happening. That is why I told you have to be prepared. Momentum in October. I said, before the election, you must have momentum, because the consequences are coming in November, and they have arrived. They have arrived. First wave hit me yesterday. There were some smaller ways before, but a big one hit yesterday, a real big one, a real big decree saying you have to die right now. And I felt like if I went along with it, if my will was broken, I was going to die that very day. I could have died yesterday if I didn't have the will to say no. I said, I don't consent to this. I do not consent to it. And they'll keep the pressure on. They'll keep the pressure on. But I keep saying a big boost is going to come here. I really have seen that. And so if you decide, no, first step, do not consent to your death. That's the first step. Second step, do not consent to re-education. Okay, so I won't say, no, I don't consent to that either. But first things first, do not consent to your death. That's the important one. Okay, and because that's the decree that's going out right now. So you have my permission to not consent to your death, certainly. Not that you need anyone's permission, but it might help. Say, wait a minute. Clarity Ross said, no, he didn't consent. I don't have to consent either. Forget it. I'm not consenting either. You can say that. You can say that. Yeah, why not? If it's helpful. If it's not helpful, then forget about it. But it's super important. You say, no, I do not consent to my death. And I'm not consenting to be re-educated into the agenda of the intellect. I do not consent to that. But first things, do not consent to your death at this point. Dismiss the decree and say, no, no consent. I don't give it. We'll discuss it later, maybe. Just push it off. Say, well, maybe later, but you have no consent for my death. No, I will not give you consent. I will not consent to my death. I will not do it. No, and no, and no. That's it. And that decree will back off. The intellect will have to back off. It's shocked. It's stunned. It doesn't know what to do. It's totally stunned because it believes it is the ultimate authority. So how could you be standing up to it? That is the problem. The intellect is certain that it is the ultimate authority. Well, this is the ultimate authority within a hypothetical scenario, but the hypothetical scenario is nothing. It has no authority over reality, and the voice of clarity within you is the voice of reality, which is the only authority there is. So that authority can certainly stand up to the intellect. So you have within you to stand up to the intellect and say, no, I do not consent. You have it within you. All of us do. All of us do. Even those who are being intimidated by the intellect and going along, they have it too. They have it too. It's just that they're not familiar with exercising it. It's kind of like they're in a wheelchair and they don't realize they can walk because they don't take the effort to get out of that wheelchair. But those of us who know we can walk. And we say, no. No, no consent. No deal. No consent. Absolutely not. And you can turn it around. Turn it around. Stay viable here. And the big boost is bound to come. It is bound to come. I've seen it coming. And it could very well be very soon, actually, because I've seen it coming in 2012, really. I really have. And it hasn't come yet, so I'm thinking, wow, maybe I wonder if it's not going to come at all. But the decree has now gone out. I saw it coming after this decree was given out that we must vacate our bodies if we're not willing to go along with the agenda of the intellect. We must vacate. It came after that point. And since that decree has already gone out on November 26th, it is quite possible that the big boost will be coming along very soon, within a matter of days. Possibly before December 21st, or maybe on December 21st. It is very possible. I'm telling you, that is the time. We are that far along right now. And I hope some of you have been watching this video, because this is the best one I've made by far. Because I'm really feeling it now. I've got my spirit back. I've pushed back against the entire situation. The entire situation tried to get me to vacate my body yesterday, and I said no. I was able to say no. And in doing so, that has freed up my spirit to be even more courageous and adamant and to say these things that I'm saying right now. Because I know I can stand up and say no to it. And the big boost is coming very soon. So hang in there right now. That is very important. Hang in there. You can do it. You will do it. You will do it. You're in good shape. You're in great shape. Stand up to that decree and say no. No, I'm not vacating my body. No way. Certainly not now, okay? You're out of luck. Forget it. It's not going to happen. No. Like that. And you have to stick with it. Maybe it doesn't seem to sink in because, again, the intellect believes it's the authority, so it can't believe what it's hearing. It cannot. I had to really stand up and just be adamant, and gradually it backed off. Like that. It's like, oh, like some kind of force field. You know, it was forcing it to back off. But initially, it didn't believe me. It just said, what are you talking? I don't understand what you're saying. You have to really feel it and know it and decree it yourself and your own will and your own clarity, and you must stick with it. Be determined, and it'll almost act like a force field, and it will push the intellect back and push it away, and it has to stand back and put that gun away, you know, say, wow, I'm not able to do it. Somehow I'm not able to do it because there's a greater authority saying no to it. But it takes some stick-to-itiveness. You can't just say like one time, say no. It takes more than that. You have to battle it. There may be some battle going on with you. Some battle going on. And if there is, let me know. If there's some battle you think, wow, I can't win this battle. This is too much for me. Maybe I can be of some help. Somebody asked me, actually, for that today. I'm considering it. I'm considering, like, Skyping with some people if I can do it. I don't know if I can or not. If they're in a situation like they're feeling like they're having trouble with this. It's possible now because of this decree has gone out that some of you might be having troubles, actually. Some of you might be having some troubles. I don't know. Maybe intellect doesn't feel so threatened by you at this point. And maybe it feels very threatened by me, and as it should, not threatened in the way it believes, but it should feel threatened that I can stand up to it. That is for sure. Because I know its game. I know what's going on. So, but it's possible some of you are feeling like, wow, this is like very, very, I'm feeling very, very, like some kind of demand that I die is hitting me or something. So maybe I could be a help. It's possible. I have an open mind to that. I'm giving it some thought. And someone did ask me for a Skype session, and I'm considering it. It's under consideration. I might do it. Let me see. I mean, yesterday I was too sick to do it. Now I'm feeling a lot better today, and if I feel better tomorrow, maybe I will do it. We'll see. I'll explore the possibility. If there's some of you who feeling like, hey, things are getting a little scary now. I'm feeling like there's some kind of demand being put on me that somehow is getting into me. If that's happening, so we'll see. We'll see. I'm keeping an open mind to it. It's very possible. So very great. This has been incredible. It's been incredible. Incredible video. I hope you've watched this video, and I'll put up a description. Please watch this video, because it's important. It's really important. We're down to the nitty-gritty right now, and when the times get tough, the tough get going, and we need to get going. All right, hang in there. Very great.